Fiala is a common name in the Czech Republic.
I was trapped in this farm situation where there was no future for a mind like mine. And I was literally crying, and I was going down the road, and someone put their hand on my shoulder. And it turned out to be like my guardian angel saying, "Harvey, there's better days ahead." So, and from that instant on, I felt good about everything because I knew that that wasn't going to be a forever situation. I never lost a job or was fired or terminated. While I was at Hughes for 3.5 years, I was a project engineer on a project to measure the speed of gravitational interaction. The Army, the Air Force, and the Navy all wrote to me asking me for a device that would produce negative gravitational pulses.
When I worked at Hughes Aircraft, I was a missile systems engineer.
The first Falcon case is opened, and one of the 111-pound missiles is set in place for testing.
When I was a project engineer on an infrared-guided missile, and in one test, there was a ring with about an 18-inch diameter, red-hot ring that was an infrared target. From 10 miles away, they fired and went through that hoop without touching it. That shows how precise it was. Then another missile, this had a bigger fat part in it where they had an atomic bomb in it. When they had to take that apart, it was a very tricky process. I could take an antenna off and reach into a hole and unconnect a Deutsch connector in there so they could run tests on it. They used to call me Dr. Fiala because it's like performing surgery on a human being, and I performed surgery on a missile. I actually worked on a Surveyor spacecraft, which went to the moon. Then I joined Rockwell International.
And I designed and developed a two-way laser communication system with video and voice going each way. We demonstrated for the Navy.
Then I worked on the shuttle for 27 and a half years. On the shuttle, IBM built the primary flight control system, and if that failed, Rockwell designed a backup flight system so that if one failed, the other shouldn't fail. And I was in charge of testing the verification and validation of the backup flight system software. There were about 8 or 9 people under me.
I attended the first launch of the first space shuttle.
5 minutes, 4, we have main engine start. And we have a lift off.
And we saw the landing of the space shuttle.
2, 1,
now. There were only 4 people on the planet that attended both the launch and the landing. And one of them was me, the president of North American Aviation, and one was the publicity director, and in other words, the vice president of the United States.
Welcome home, Columbia. Beautiful, beautiful.
I earned a minor degree in artificial intelligence, and I've had a motto: artificial intelligence is better than none. I had a tax practice for over 20 years, and I became the first enrolled agent to practice before the Internal Revenue Service as a tax preparer. I handled between 2 and 3 dozen audits, so I have 2 years of a law degree. I had a diamond business, became a certified gemologist by the Gemological Institute of America. I've been an editor, and I like to write and publish.
I was licensed to perform marriages. I have married several members of my own family.
Einstein.
Albert Einstein was my 8th cousin once removed.
Einstein had a 3rd son, and that was kept secret from the whole world. Elsa Einstein, she was 55 years old. She wasn't supposed to have a baby. That baby was raised by another family, and that family was the Zockel family. Ludwig Zockel is actually the son of Albert Einstein, and the Zockel family married into 3 different branches of the Fialas through adoptive parents and through marriages. I'm related to Ludwig Zockel Einstein, the 3rd son of Albert Einstein.
If you go back, roughly 9 generations, there was a Fiala. 2 Fiala brothers had cousins. 5 or 6 generations of Fialas. Finally, they married into the Zockels, which adopted the son of Albert and Elsa Einstein.
I was seeking out these relatives. Dr. Chopek introduced me to the newspaper editor in Brno, Moravia, and they got my story. The story is basically there's this Fiala from California seeking out his relatives. So if you think you're related to him, write him a letter. And so 6 months later, I got a letter in the mail saying, my name is Dr. Ludiek Zockel, actually Zockel Einstein. I am a son of Albert Einstein. He says, I am your relative. I says, wow, that's good if that's true. And so I pursued that very, very heavily.
The connection to Albert Einstein is that Bojena Zakova and Dr. Ludiek Zockel Einstein. On 5 of my 7 trips to the Czech Republic, I was a guest at the home of Dr. Ludiek Zockel Einstein, third son of Albert Einstein. Ludiek Zockel Einstein's parents were related to 3 different branches of the Fialas. I and our 10 children are related to Albert Einstein. I am the only living person that spoke to Ludiek and Bojena and can verify Ludiek was Einstein's son.
E is equal mc square, in which energy is put equal to mass multiplied with the square of the velocity of light, showed that very small amount of mass may be converted into a very large amount of energy.
I was born a Catholic, and I'm a diehard Catholic. I received 5 of the 7 sacraments in the Catholic Church. I was in the church choir for 56 years. I served at the 7 a.m. daily mass at St. John's University and North Dakota State University. In 1989, Bonnie and I visited Pope John Paul II at the Vatican. God for a miracle, and he granted it.
In the year 2000, I was working on our motorhome, and it had it up on a block and on a ramp, and I was under it, and it rolled off the block and rolled right onto my hips. I knew I was a goner. My whole life flashed before my mind. My guardian angel, that's the way I interpret it, pushed the motorhome back off of me, and I survived that. I was in the hospital a few days, but that was a miracle that I got out of that thing alive.
Czechoslovakia had been under communist control for 40 years. Families didn't dare own a Bible, and they were allowed to go to church once on Sunday. And so I ended up buying several leather-bound Bibles and delivering them to relatives or Catholic families, places that I stayed at. I was born in the Great Depression in the 1930s, the worst in modern history. At age 3, our house was on fire. I crawled under the bed and my mother found me there.
When I was 12 years old, my dad took me to his dad's funeral. During World War II, they had rationing, and you could only buy so much gasoline or tires. Even sugar was rationed. And once I snuck in the kitchen and swallowed 2 tablespoons full of sugar, and I got sick from it. And so to this day, I can't stand sugar. I had a cat once called her Mother Angora. She had like 9 lives, and she ended up getting a leg cut off, and then another leg cut off, and both ears froze off, and then she became blind, and we nursed her in the basement. And finally, when spring came, I and my brothers walked out to the pasture, dug a little hole, put her in a shoebox, and I used a .22 rifle, put her out of her misery and buried her and said prayers over her and went back home, and we lived happily ever after. of my claims to fame is that I married Bonnie Kiefer.
After 55 years, I love, cherish, and appreciate Bonnie even more for giving us 10 healthy children.
In 2012, I was able to make the statement that there's one man and one woman. We had 5 sons and 5 daughters, and we had 12 grandsons and 12 granddaughters. And after that, more grew, and I haven't kept track of them. Our 10 children have names of saints and different biblical names. And
our son John was born, then Pope John was elected. Our son Paul was born, then Pope Paul was elected. Next, son Harvey, Andrew Benedict, then Pope Benedict was elected.
That's kind of a rare coincidence where such a string of popes were named after our own children. That's the way I'd like to look at it.
When Bonnie and I took a weekend off to go to Palm Springs, we saw Desi Arnaz.
We flew to Hawaii 6 times, and Kauai was our favorite island. One time, we went to the west coast of Kauai and lay on a blanket. We were official comet watchers.
Bonnie and I crossed Germany to visit her 5th cousins in the Alsace-Lorraine, France. We celebrate our 55th wedding anniversary in 2012.
From Caltech in 1959. But back at NDSU, I graduated highest grade point average and the highest starting salary. I graduated summa cum laude.
In college, I started solving problems algebraically with parameters instead of numerically.
At Caltech, one of my instructors was Dr. Richard Feynman. 6 years later, he was awarded a Nobel Prize. And so this is one of the greatest things in my life, to have had him for an instructor in physics and mathematics. And he like mentored me on 3 or 4 different projects relating to gravity research and inertial propulsion. At Caltech, my master's thesis was on the optimum design of gravitational antennas for maximum gain. We could communicate by gravity, which is instantaneous, and it's been proven now to be instantaneous. And if we were able to generate signals strong enough and receive them, we could have a communication system where I'd be talking to someone on Mars, we could talk in real time.
Marty Parker said that I need cognitive restructuring. My mind is very creative on plane trips, vacations, at hotels and conferences.
When I was jogging, your blood gets flowing and you get more oxygen in your brain and suddenly you can think clearly. And I have solved a lot of problems while jogging.
On most new technical books, I can usually find errors in just a few minutes. I speak English, some Czech, some German, and a little bit of Spanish.
I coined the phrase, I'd rather die owing it to you than cheat you out of it.
My brother Fred and Elvis Presley both served in the Air Force at the same time.
Kids always got good Christmas presents.
During Fiala get-togethers in Valparaiso, Nebraska, for entertainment, I was a stand-up comedian.
I used to have a list of 100 jokes. I had a small dance band. I swam with the dolphins, I rode on one, and I even kissed a dolphin. I caught a 28-pound sea bass, and it's the last time I fished. I figured, quit while I'm ahead.
I drove on the Autobahn with no speed limit.
When I was young, they had mandatory draft for World War II.
I remember the hour that JFK was assassinated on Friday, November 22nd, 1963. I was on my way to work.
We had a 41 Chevrolet, brand new, and Dad bought it for $650. One of my favorite foods is just plain old corn on the cob, green beans. Everyone loves lobster. And of course, cheesecake.
I climbed Mount Whitney with three others. Two of them were experts. Only I and one other lasted.
I'd like to, if we'd long enough to see men land on Mars. It'd mean a lot to me.
Until 1972, I thought it was wrong to take a nap. Now I have to take a nap every day.
For our first four children, in the waiting room while they're being born, I watched the World Series.
We had a lot of nice trees in our backyard. Fig tree, pepper tree, apple tree. People said I had a green thumb, but I didn't really.
I picked 1,183 cherries off of one vine.
And there was like at least 5,000 green ones left on it. That's kind of a world record.
Frosted window panes, candles gleaming inside, painted candy canes on the tree. Santa's on his way, he's filled his sleigh with things, things for you and for me. It's that time of year when the world falls in love. Every song you hear seems to say, Merry Christmas, may your New Year dreams come true. Song of mine in three-quarter time wishes you and yours the same thing too.
I've got a short leg. I've had a cervical fusion. I have chronic fatigue, tinnitus, foot neuropathy, glaucoma, trifocal, urinary urgency, compromised immune system, and CIDP, chronic inflammatory demyelination polyneuropathy, and I lose balance on the right side. It's amazing that I'm still alive, but I've learned to live with it.
I used a small bouncer for exercise for 1 year, and due to my spine, I lost 3/4 of an inch in 1 year, so I never used it again. I had rotator cuff surgery on my left shoulder and on my right shoulder in 2012.
At the age of 13, in a hayrack accident, got my leg broken off, torn off, is hanging on by the Achilles tendon only, and it's a miracle that it's back. And I have a short leg, and That was a turning point in my life. I was laid up for a long time and on crutches and wheelchair, and I started reading encyclopedias from our neighbor's encyclopedia book. After I'd had my accident, my dad bought me a Jowett muscle building course, and I practiced that every day. I became very strong. In fact, I had such abdominal muscles that if I tensed them up, you could punch me in the stomach and it wouldn't faze me at all. It's like our bodies are slowly being taken away from us, and your mind is like a muscle. Use it or lose it. And I use mine every day as much as I can. I'm always very busy, but I have several hobbies. One of them is coin collecting. Like when I was young back on the farm, I had a coin collection with old mercury dimes and quarters and Indian head pennies and so forth, and buffalo nickels, and someone stole it and bought candy with it. No, I'm not going to mention any names now, but it was someone I knew. One regret that I had is, when I retired, I had like $300,000 in the savings plan, and it was all in Rockwell stock. And Rockwell stock wasn't doing that great, and so I sold a lot of the stock. My regret is I shouldn't have sold the stock. I should have taken a loan against it, because at that time the stock was worth like $25, and now it's gone up to 60 or 70 and split twice, and if I had just taken a loan on it and paid the loan off, then I'd have still had $1 million worth of stock.
was technical editor of the North Dakota State Engineer for 2 years. I won the Tau Beta Pi annual essay contest. I've been a member of the John Birch Society for 55 years.
So I was very good in mathematics. I earned a Howard Hughes Master of Science Fellowship. We were supporting Barry Goldwater in the presidential race, and we went to a fundraising event, and they were raffling off a new bicycle, like a seven-digit number. And I was sitting at a table with about eight people with Bonnie, and they raffled off a lot of things. Now, this was the final prize, and I said like seven, and he says, the first number is seven. Then he says, okay, we're now ready for the next number, and I said, two. He said, a two. And the people at my table start to look at me, see? The bottom line is, I predicted all seven numbers, and I won the motorcycle. The whole crowd was looking at me because I would stand up and say the number, and we won it, and it's as if I had perfect mental telepathy or something, see? I was lucky like that, but never any big prize, never won like a lotto or anything like that.
At its worst, it was hard to see, hard to breathe, and hard to go outside for days. There were giant black clouds of dust that would swallow the countryside. During these brutal years, Harvey almost died from whooping cough at the age of one. The family had to use a bucket for the bathroom because they couldn't go outside to the outhouse. Dad had a rope tied from the house to the barn, so that if there was even the slightest let up in the storm, they could go check on the animals. It was hard to protect your tractor. Fine sand would penetrate the carburetor and wind up in the fuel line. Entire plows could get buried and only the levers would be visible. At times, after coming outside after a storm, you couldn't find things. You could see, but you felt disoriented because the landscape would look so different. Tumbleweeds would blow against the fences and get trapped. The dirt would just pile up on them to the point where it would bury the fence. Planted seeds would shrivel and die in the ground before they could ever sprout. With no plants to trap the soil or moisture, the parched dirt turned to powder that was easily carried away by the wind. the 1930s marked a decade of the worst drought in U.S. history. At the Carpenter State Beach, they had a lagoon. When the tide would come in and flow over the sand, it would fill up a low area. And that was maybe 5 feet deep. And it was so full, and it was ready to overflow. And I and the kids, we took our hand and started scraping a little path in the sand so the water trickled through that. And we kept nursing it along over maybe 100 feet. Kept nursing along, and the water started to flow more rapidly, and pretty soon it started to carry the sand with it, and it went from a small channel just a few inches wide and deep into something 10 feet wide and like 5 feet deep. And it was rushing. Man, that was, I got video of that on the Super 8 movies, and that was called Draining Lagoon, and that's one of the most memorable experiences of our 80 different campouts. In 2011, I obtained two patents on inertial propulsion, and it's useful for on-orbit station keeping. I just have a humble model of an inertial propulsion system in my garage. It has only one moving part.
It works off the Earth's gravitational field.
This is Harvey Fiala and inertial propulsion.
It turns out that this device is the very, very first approach that controls gravity. Gravity is a downward force, and this converts to a sideways motion. The active mass goes in uniform circular motion on the chassis, but now the chassis is moving under it as a reaction to the motion of the active mass. And inertial propulsion does not use a propellant. It uses energy of a solar cell to turn the rotor. The rotor is balanced to 10 parts in a million, called a super high precision gyro. This traction ring is such a high precision device, it's actually a hoop for crocheting. This here is just a brass bar, and this is a 3/16 aluminum tubing,
and simple wheels. They have a lot of friction. I built what I could. You can see it's on a track that's calibrated. My memory's not that great. That's calibrated either in inches or kilometers or light years. I just forgot. But you can see it moves forward about 2 inches and backward about an inch. And that's because for half of the cycle, it's in traction. The other half, it's in precession. This is traction, precession, traction, precession. During traction, it has full inertia. During precession, it has only about half of its inertia. You can see it moves forward maybe 3 inches and back 2 inches or something. And you can see that there's a point of a dead stop. Now, if it had a second rotor, it'd never stop. If you had four of them, it'd go 10 feet a minute or something like that.
I feel like God put me on this planet to bring inertial propulsion to the world.
I just want to mention this. Going up toward the speed of light with inertial propulsion, in the speed of sound, as you approach the speed of sound, the noise of the aircraft is going ahead of you, but pretty soon when you approach the speed of sound, the noise accumulates in a big noise front, and you enter that, that's a sonic boom, and it can shatter your aircraft if you don't know what you're doing. You gotta go through it rapidly, and you gotta have enough rigidity to, now, the speed of light, and if there was an ether boom, and now this is humor, if you had headlights on your craft and you were catching up to the light beam and it was going to be super brilliant, which might burn you up, then right before you pass through the ether boom, turn your headlights off.
Welcome to my world. Won't you come on in? Miracles, I guess, still happen now and then. Step into my heart. Leave your cares behind. Welcome to my world, built with you in mind. Knock and the door will open. Seek and you the key to this world of mine. I'll be waiting here with my arms unfurled, waiting just for you. Welcome to my world. Waiting just for you. Welcome to my.
I devised a round disc with holes in it, double density plugs in it. Spin that around in the near zone field. You can develop an arbitrary waveform, a pulse waveform, a sine waveform, even a negative pulse waveform. And I solved for the altitude of an irregular tetrahedron, the radius of 5 mutually externally tangent spheres. And most people think that's not even possible.